Welcome everyone to New South Wales DPI Dairies webinar number 6, Cow Signals, Robotic Milking and 5 Lactations. My name is Nicholas Lyons. I am the Development Officer for Robotic Milking Systems within the New South Wales Department of Primary Industries. This is a national role supporting technology adoption on Australian dairy farms with a particular focus but not limited to robotic milking systems. Today we have the great privilege of having an international guest speaker with us that is on the screen for most of you. Mr. Joep Driessen was born and raised on a Dutch dairy farm. He is a qualified vet and the founder of Vetvice and Cow Signals in the Netherlands. Joep has a different approach in looking what is best for the cows and understanding their behavior. In doing so, he works with farmers, feed advisors, vets, and all sorts of advisory experts in the agricultural business in more than 50 countries, which gives him a unique knowledge and experience of dairy farming under different production systems. Joep has developed training programs that help improve the cow's life and the farmer's income and working pleasure. He has the aim of making the world more sustainable by treating cows right, something that could potentially help reduce methane emissions by up to 30%. I have personally followed Joep's work for some time now, and we met personally during a trip last year. We have also engaged Cow Signals trainers at our annual AMS gathering before here in Australia. In this occasion, Joep has kindly volunteered his time after some chasing to share with us his insight into Cow Signals, robotic milking, and 5 lactations. This presentation will be mostly focused on understanding cow behavior in dairy farming systems, with a focus on robotic milking and working together with the cow to improve cow longevity. So Joep, it is a great privilege for us to have you share some of your knowledge and wisdom with us today. So the floor is yours. I'll share presenter right with you right now. So you should be free to go. People should be able to see you.
Yeah. And can you put me also in the chat box, my little picture, like you did before? Yep. Everybody can hear me?
Everybody should everybody be able to hear you, and everybody sees the screen. I'm monitoring it. So everybody ready to go.
Okay, guys. Well, Joep Driessen here, and a nice introduction from Nicholas. We want to talk about cow signals, and I'm Joep Driessen from the Cow Signals Training Company. We talk about cow signals for robot milkers, and I've been working for 20-something years with robots now, and the very first robot farmer came with me on a bus to England traveling, and he had two cows, Berta and Clara. They always go together from the field to the robot, and they wait for each other, and after they're finished, they go back in the pasture. And it was a really interesting story. He said, like women, cows are women. They go together. We see this happening. The women go together to the toilet and in the pub and the disco. So it's very interesting to see that what cows do. And we have 5-6 different systems now. We have 2,500 robots running in blue ones in Holland, 2,500 red ones. So 25% of all the robots Europe, in Holland, are 25% of the cows are milked by milk robots. And we also have the Bomatic, the SAC, the GEA, and the Full Woods. All these systems are operational, but the market leaders are the two on the top, the blue and the red one, and they're both very good. I have no bias or no anything. They're both very good functioning. One remark, they all have free cow traffic systems, almost all of them in Holland. So there's no difference between these two robots and the systems in Holland. We have free access for cows, so no feed first or milk first issues. That's not a good idea for cows, and the Dutch farmers know it because they have about 22 years experience with robotic milking. Same in Denmark, by the way. Cow signals for robotic milk is, how do you get a healthy, productive cow who likes to walk to the robot? That is a big question for me and for you and for the cows. So how do you get them, how do you can you keep them healthy, and how do you make them easily walk to the robot? Well, the most people who start robotic milking have the fear that the cows won't come. The cows will only come when you give them a reward. You see that you need a cookie. And if they don't get a nice cookie, it can be even palliative grain, but it can also be nice formed concentrate that is made by the feed companies. But it has to be tasty, high starch product in this robot, because then the cows will like to go there. And that is the only reason you go there. They don't go there because they like to be milked. Only maybe the first 2 days where they have huge pressure on the udders, but that's still a bit painful. So they don't really like to be milked. Cows like to have a cookie, and they will get milked. Then number two, the cows need a good access, and that means absolutely free cow traffic, and that means 6 to 8 meters free space in front of the robot. Especially if you have two or more of them. So 6 to 8 meters free space, like a play garden, like a social place, very big success factor. And number one, the cow has to be healthy, and very important, healthy hooves. A lame cow you can still push to the milk machine, but you can't get her in the robot very easily because she has to go voluntarily. If you have more than 5% cows to pick up, an average farm with 100 cows only picks up 3 cows in the morning, and that is not seen as a job. It's only like an easy cleaning round of your barn, and oh, by the way, I will take these 2 or 3 cows to the robot area, and then they will walk in. So it's not a lot of work. It's actually very easy work, and most cows will do the work by themselves. What do we want? We want to have, what does the cow want? And that's the big question. We want to earn money and to have happy and healthy cows. But the cows, what does the cow want? Well, she wants to stay healthy. She doesn't want to have any antibiotics or any wounds or lameness. She wants to stay healthy. She also wants to be stress-free, and it's a very big thing. One of the questions was already asked by you in the webinar. How do you get a new cow in a robot? How do you start up? Well, with as little stress as possible. So before the robot comes, start walking around your cows, talk to them. Every time they move in a way, you step back, say hello to them. Make sure you don't overstress them. Stay out of their pressure zone and learn them that you can guide them. They have to learn that you are the boss and that you are the leader. And that is a lot of stress-free stockmanship stuff. We have a video learning on that. But that's very important, stress-free stockmanship. And then we need to take care of the basics. So we want to have excellent feed, water, light, air, rest, and space. And the ultimate goal is that we can go from 30,000 to 50,000 liters lifetime production, and that is exactly what the best 1% farmers in Holland are doing. 5 lactations of 10,000 liters. It's possible for her average. This is set up for the Australian farmers, but we're very happy that we launched it yesterday on internet, and we have another 100 people coming in, so we're very happy that you all were interested to join this webinar. It's already a big success. I think we have almost 150 people joining in. Two questions that came on in the application form. How profitable is it to focus on cow behavior and maybe cow welfare? But cow behavior tells you everything. How profitable is it? Well, the answer is very profitable. I show you that if you can, for example, by looking carefully at cows, understanding their behavior better, if you give them what they need, feed, water, light, air, rest, and space, then you can let your cows live for 6 lactations. If you see this here, this is an interesting graph of the best 23,000 cows of Holland from the last 10 years. Almost 9,000 cows, Dutch dairy cows, with 100,000 liters. And I normally ask the question, like, what do you think? Which lactation is the highest? Well, almost nobody guesses this because it's only the 6th and the 7th. 6, 7, and 8. Are the highest lactations, the most efficient lactations with the best feed efficiency. So if you can keep your cows longer, you make big money. So the big challenge is for every system to let your cows live longer, happily, and don't let them get lame. So we have a feed efficiency of 1.5, or the robot farmer was yesterday, he was on 1.7, could hardly believe it. Actually, the moment he was 1.63 with 5 hours grazing, and he kicks all the 100 cows out twice a day for 2.5 hours or 3 hours, and then there's no milking at all. So that's possible with 100 cows. If you have 140 cows, high yielding cows on 2 robots, that will be the ultimate max and the moment. So we say 60 cows per robot basically, so 120 high yielding cows on to robots, but he's with 100 cows and he still can afford 5 hours grazing, 5 to 6 hours, and then the milkings go back to 2.5 milkings per day because there's less time to be milked. But is it profitable to look at cow behavior? Well, I can promise you yes, and we've been doing this since 1999. We started the first cow signals lecture, and every farm we have been doing cow signals, they go up in milk and longevity. So it's two things. Second question, what are the top five things you look at when you're visiting a farm? Well, actually, I try to look through the eyes of the cow. The cow is always telling the truth, and the cow is never lying. You just have to see what she sees. And I really mean going to that level, so go down, and try to look on that level and go down in the cubicle, and what do you see? What do you see when you're a cow? And what do you think when you're a cow? Well, they probably don't think very deeply, but they are very primitive animals. They have a very direct flight and herd behavior in them. So they want to be together, and they want to fly rather than fight. And if you understand a cow better, you can do a better job on your own, every dairy in the world. We work on all the systems. We work in 66 countries now, and I'm very thankful for all the farmers that were sharing their best knowledge with me. And we summarized everything now in all our video learnings and all our books. So the simple concept is look, think, act, see, hear, feel, smell everything, ask a little, look for you knows and explain notable observations, and check waiting cows, because cows have no time to wait, okay? So then look for risk animals, risk places, and risk moments, and then you think, what are the causes of that behavior or that that you know or that waiting cow? Why is this cow standing there? Like yesterday, very good farm, but still 4 out of 10 cows were standing in the beds, not resting, because he has mattress barns which are not large enough. The bed was only 170. The cows are 2 meters. They cannot rest in this bed good enough, so you make it not comfortable enough for the cows. So you can always find some causes. And the other things are water, light, and air, for example. In most barn systems, they are very, very limited, and they can always be improved very cheaply. So this is the cheap side of the diamond. And then if you earn money with this, you can also invest in deep beds, better, bigger beds, more space for the cows, and more feed. And then act, do something, because the cow will always pay you back in health and liters of milk and longevity. And in the meantime, we have 30% methane reduction if we double the lifetime of the cow from 2.5 to 5 lactations. So in Australia, Jan Hulsen was here, my colleague, to make this photo, and he said, well, these Australian farmers, they are looking at the grass like Kiwi farmers, they're looking at the grass like Chile farmers, like every grazing system, South African farmers, they look at the grass and they don't look at the cows anymore. And this cow has an empty rumen, she has a curved back, the head is low and the ears are hanging. So she actually comes to the farm to tell them that she's not all right, but the farmers are busy discussing the grass. And if you don't look at early signs of lameness, discomfort, and lack of feed intake in this danger triangle on the left side of the cow, then you miss the point. Your cow is always trying to help you in your management. Your cow is your best management advisor. So it's about the difference between looking and seeing and what you do with all this information. And trying to really immediately trim a lame cow. And this is very important in robot systems. We also have a full package, a book and a whole package for teachers as well, workshops in grazing systems. It's focused on grazing, herding, and milking, so it's the same cow signals, especially for grazing systems. I worked for several weeks in New Zealand, and I found a few funny you-knows, unclarified, unexplained, notable observations. You see something, but you don't know what it means, and I come in this field, and I think, what is this? So I look, and I see all these cows doing different things. And it's very interesting to see, because they were just feeding hay on top of the grass, and you see most cows are eating and they're spread well out because there's enough feed space, that's good. And then you look, well, what else are they doing? And then you see this you know here, okay, she's calving, right, she's eating grass. Why is she not eating hay? She probably doesn't eat it, or she likes the grass better. Another one eating grass here, so this one walks away from the feeding table, and this one is in the middle of nowhere. So I look, what are the cows doing? And this cow was seeing me with a camera, and this one too. So what are the cows telling you? What do they want? So what are they doing? And do you see all the UNOs? I see a lot of UNOs around the world. Have nothing to do with robotic milking, but what is she eating? And what are they doing? They look very hairy and not very shiny. So what do you see? A quick question. This is an outside feed pad and typical in grazing systems. So use your chat box and tell me what you see. I can tell you everything, but I'd like you to observe yourself. What is good in this system and what is not so good? So in your chat box, on your GoToWebinar meeting place, you can enter some information. What do you see? Nicholas, can you put my picture also in this GoToWebinar box that I can see my own picture myself in the top?
Yeah, well, we are seeing you. So. The audience can see you too. Somebody there says the cable in the feed fence is too low.
Yeah, very good. And that's a critical one. And this is an irritating stop. Very good observation. What else? Well, almost all the cows can eat. If you look carefully, there's some cows they can't eat, right? So they are still cruising around, and there's quite a few cows waiting for food on this side. And one more thing I'm always very keen on, what I see here is actually this. Shit on my feet, you see? So we really try to not drive through shit when we work on the feeding table. A very clean line, because it's not nice to have shit on your plate.
Somebody said exactly that, that there's shit in the feed table and the feed levels are too low.
Yeah. Okay, and then the feed level, exactly, the feed level is the same height as the cows are standing. That's another good observation. So that makes it a bit more difficult for the cows to eat, and there's more pressure on the front hooves, and that creates lameness. So it is a risk factor as well. So a very nice setup, but it's still how do you manage it, and this could be actually moved a bit further ahead. We like to make the rail 30 to 35 centimeters ahead, still keeping the cows in, but you don't want to bother the cows in the neck. It's good that it's low enough that it's not on the bone, it's on the band of the neck, but still it's stopping the cow too much. And now she can hardly reach the last feed. So looking at this, what cow signals can bring you, observe carefully and knowing what to do. And we like to have happy cows, happy farmers, and happy milk that is produced by healthy cows. So that also my children can drink milk from happy, healthy cows, not lame and less antibiotic use. Our system should be very, very open. If you build a barn like we do in Western Europe and America, building barns, we like to have barns with two-row systems. China only builds two-row systems, maximum cross ventilation and a stress-free calving line. And one place to eat of 70 centimeters per cow that every cow can eat. Now we go to robot milking. So the choice is you do this, a big rotary or a 2x20 swing over or whatever you have at home, or you go for robotic milking. So, well, what is the biggest advantage from robotic milking? You tell me in your chat box. And Nicholas, can you show me the chat box as well? I can see it as well. Is it possible? I don't see chats coming in.
You should see it on the right on the GoToMeeting kind of floating screen. You should be able to, if you press on chat, you should be able to see the chat box. But somebody there says one of the reasons for robotic milking is low stress milking.
Yeah, low stress milking. Yeah, that's one. That's true. There's no man involved, and the machine is always the same, so there's less stress because it's every day the same. What else is a benefit?
Yeah, consistency is one of them. That's a good one.
Yeah, consistency, yeah.
Increased milking.
Yeah, 3x milking instead of 2x milking, which is very helpful, of course. If you normally would milk twice, you have less pressure in the udder. The biggest success factor, in my opinion, is not having cows waiting. Because what I just already said, a waiting cow is your best management advisor. Your waiting cow is telling you that something is going wrong. The cow doesn't have time to wait, and the hoof is not made to walk on concrete. cows shouldn't stand on concrete. They are not made for it, especially not in the 6 weeks around calving. So if you understand the anatomy of the cow, that the cows cannot not survive concrete very well, then this what you see here, huge herds, big powers, but still twice a day, 3 to 5 hours of milking time standing on concrete is like very common in most in all places in the world. This leads to 54% lameness in New York State and Pennsylvania, where they have two small parlors and two big herds and overcrowding. One thing is the 5 hours, 4.8 hours milking time in New York State at the moment on the big farms. And that is far too much. So 4.8 hours milking time in combination with overstocking in the building, which is really bad, is the 3 times 6 minutes milking time that you have in a robot, in a voluntary milking system. You have no waiting at all, free cow traffic, so no gates in front of a robot. Every cow can decide wherever she wants to go to be milked and eat and drink. So never ever block this area off. That's a big mistake that's being made by several companies when they launched robots, including Lely, including Deleval, including Gea. They all came up with systems, with forced cow traffic systems, which was a big mistake for the whole dairy industry. So we see a huge impact in labor efficiency, and a huge impact in longevity, and an impact on milk production. And that's why I'm such a big fan of robotic milking. I've been following it for 22 years. What I said, all robot companies started with a guided cow flow system, Lely, Deleval, Gea, and now I'm very happy that it all come with a free cow traffic system, because that is one of the big success factors, that you leave the cows completely relaxed and give them no waiting time. And then they can go whatever they want. They can go 5 times to the robot. They will be milked roughly 2.8 times or up to 3 times even. Depends on the pressure on your robot, how many cows you have on a robot. If you have 60 cows on a robot or 65 on one robot, then you can still have 2.9 milkings, and that's really an excellent average. The success factors of our barn. So this was a 4-robot barn. Now you see here 1, 2, 3. There's 4 robots, 4 robot boxes in this building, and you see a stress-free calving line. So here you see the dry cow area. Here you see the pre-calving and after calving areas. Here's the fresh calf. What do you see here? What's the biggest? There's 2 things that are not right in this picture. So this is a 240 cow barn. What is not right? If you want to say 2 things. I still don't see any cats.
This is a difficult one.
That's difficult. There's 2 things that are not right here. So tell me. I see a picture of Bob Lewis now. Bob Lewis is watching as well. So sometimes I see people coming by who's watching. But please feel free to fill in your chat box what do you see. And maybe, Nicholas, you can...
Somebody says hygiene is not optimum.
Well, I think it's pretty cool, but I see it's really clean, and there's cross ventilation in the building, so it doesn't get much cleaner than this. So I would be very happy if every farmer looked like this. But
somebody says a narrow exit for this cow from the pen.
Exactly, and there's 2 things. This wall should never be here in this gate. We want to have only fall-in sticks that you can close the gate when you need it to be closed, when you want to work in the straw yard. Okay. But you don't want to have any barrier here between the resting and eating, because this is designed for 6 cows, and now the heifer is very shy and she won't come out because a big mama will block the gate. So very good observation. Never block this area up. The stress-free calving should be very easy for the cow to go in and out. And then we have number 2 issue. There's the cows alone. Never put a cow alone in a box. And there's no cows here either. He's still not on a fully equipped house yet.
Somebody also mentioned there's no water available and there's no feed available for the fresh calver.
Yeah, no, it's a very good observation, but it's actually the feeding fans is here and the water and the feed is here. We have 2 drinkers, one in this corner, one in this corner. One more issue is that you don't want to have this wall either, because you want to drive it from the left side of the building to clean it out easily. So you want to make this wall not a wall, flexible, with 2 span bands. You can have the same effect and you can keep it out when you want to clean this area. It's a lot more labor efficient. So we look at labor efficiency, we look at cow flow and cow traffic, and we want to make life easy. Why is this cow not resting? Well, she's lame. Why is she not resting? Because she feels very uncomfortable and alone. As you can see some cows through this gate here, but don't put a cow alone. Very important is a very good treatment facility. We designed this treatment facility ourselves together with Wopa, the manufacturer in Holland, and it's a very big success. It's a treatment box for cows where you can do everything, including there's a video on the internet if you Google treatment box, and now Lely is selling it as well, but also Wopa, you can find treatment box. And this is what every farmer needs, because you want to have a very easy treatment place right here between your selection cows and your fresh cows and your calving cows. So a lot of space in front of the robot is a big success factor. Well, then a few practical issues here. This is a typical old Dutch tree row barn with three rows and narrow passages. What do you see? Waiting cows. And why is this one better? Why is it here better? Let me know in the chat box. What's the difference between here?
Well, what is the question, Joep, exactly there?
Why is this one better than this one? Here's the amount of standing cows, and this we call the lookout heifer. She's a lookout trying to find her way out to the robot. There's too many cows blocking the road.
There's two attendees that say the width of the alley, so how wide is the passageway?
Exactly. So this is a typical back alley of 2 meters or 220, and this is a back alley of 3 meters, and sometimes people make it even wider, but minimum 3 meter back alley on a three row system. And here's two robots, and this is a three row system barn. Here, most cows are resting. This is a deep bed. This is a mattress barn. Mattress is very narrow. This is a rebuild situation. People were asking me, if I do a rebuild situation, what is the most important thing? Well, if this was your old barn, the robot should be further backwards. You should put your robot outside your barn and also make a stress-free area for dry cows and fresh cows behind the robot. So in a rebuild situation, put the robot far away out of your barn, because you really need, if you have one robot, you need 4 to 6 meters. If you have two robots, you need 6 to 8 meters freedom in front of the robot. So this is all in barn systems, and you want to have maximum one cow waiting, and you don't want to have a lot of cows waiting. This is a big mistake, that a lot of cows are waiting, and people are familiar with this because they think, oh, milking is waiting. No, that's why we have robot milking, that there's no more waiting involved. And that is why cows are so happy with robot milking. So don't have any gates and force systems, because that is not good for the cow. And there's no good reason, all the arguments people are using are not correct. We wrote some articles about it, you can find more on the internet if you search for it, but you have to first understand the cow to understand why free cow traffic is better. This was actually the beginning of robot milking in Holland, and we made a lot of mistakes. And here you see a big turning block, you see sticking out metal, you see a scraper in the way, so all these things are blocking cow traffic. There's a freedom here to escape for cows, but this whole box was actually a mistake. Cows were resting in this box, and we see heifers. If you have a waiting room in front of a robot, you see heifers will actually stand there for 6, sometimes even 12 hours, because they don't dare to go in the robot, because always a big mama walks in first. And then they have no escape route, so they stand shy in the corner for hours and hours. And that's why a forced entry fence is a mistake, because you force cows in a little room where they don't want to be. So this is how it looks like in Holland. Then we have very high open buildings. We make a lot of light in the building, three sides open. And this is a farm where we have 6 months grazing and 6 months inside. And even in the winter, it's not too cold at all, so there's no big problem. Deep beds again, and many cows resting, a few cows standing here, but this is an open day and it's very busy at the moment. This was a very interesting stress-free entry. The cow signals double entry, and this little gate. Cows coming from the right here, they should come from the straw pack and go into the robot, and this cow can go to the robot. How do you get them in stress-free? Well, in the beginning, you just try to walk them in with little pressure. If this cow doesn't want to go in, then you just close this gate behind her. And now, it's very interesting what you do. Now you put a chain around here. This man is now walking out this gate. He walks this direction, all the way up here. He circles here, and then he walks from this direction along this fence. The moment he passes the shoulder, this heifer will walk in. So this heifer is stressed. You can't push her in from here because she can hardly see you. Where you stand behind the cow is the wrong place to be. The heifer is now turning her head around. Where is he? Where is he? And she's not walking in. So instead of shouting and hitting, this is stress-free stockmanship, guys. Hopefully on the next session, I want to tell you more, or just it's coming soon on our internet webinars, pay videos, you can find stress-free stockmanship. You have to walk around and walk around this way. Walk from the front to the back, outside this fence, and then you walk the cow in with natural pressure. A lot of things with single gates. Another success factor is a small step over here. And easy access, this was a finger gate system, which is quite nice. And this is how we put double robo blocks, the bomatics and the sacks, we put them in like this, which is needs a bit more space, but it's also still the option of all the cows can be selected full automatically from all the robo stations. So then you can organize your management with selection. A last thing, especially for the Australian and Kiwi and South African farmers and the Chile farmers, is robot milking in grazing systems. It's AB grazing or ABC grazing with a grazeway on the outside door. So if you don't have beds for the winter time, if you don't need them, you can skip this all these beds in the middle. The only thing you have to do is putting a robot platform up and a free space in front of the robots and a selection gate to the outside. So you have a platform in front of the robots, typically four robots, 240 cows grazing in one group, and it works very well. I checked a few farms with grazing, and I know that 80% of the farms in France with robots does grazing. In Holland, it's only 25% of the farms with robots that have grazing, or at least a walkout, typically 6 or 10 hectares for 400 cows behind the farm. So they at least have some exercise. How does it look like? Well, it's an exit door, a smart gate or a grazeway gate to send the cows out with three-way selection. One way is coming back to the field, you haven't been milked yet, and AB is then going out, and then you have another one for the other side. So the cows come in back from the field from this lane, and they come back in, and they go back to the milking platform. They come back in here. Here's come back in, A comes back in here, B comes back in here, C comes back in the back. And the machines tell you where to go. So here you see how the setup is. Here the cows go to a field. And this farmer was telling me in New Zealand, he said, well, actually, only when the grass is growing too fast, the cows don't come back. Because when there's too much grass growth in the spring, and I give them a little bit too long long field, then they don't come back voluntarily. Otherwise, most of the cows come back because they see that some of the cows already go to the next field, next door, the B field, and the grass of the neighbors is always greener. So a lot of cows slowly come back, have a good drink, come back, have some concentrate on the platform, and they can eat. And normally up to maximum 2 kilos, 2 to 7 kilos in the robot, or 0.5 kilo to 7 kilos in robots. They come out, sometimes they put even some extra concentrate feeders, and some people ask me about a feed path, and where should be the feed path? Well, the feed path can be in this area or out this area, what you want, what is the most practical, but if you want to buffer feed them at milking time, well, you can do it in the robots. And you can do it even extra out of parlor fields on the platform. Also here, complete free entry. And here they have the access in this way. I don't know why they did it like this, but here the robots are pretty close together, so they want to have the cows out here so that the entrance stays clear. I'd rather have all four robots pointing in the same direction or make the corner position that we were telling you, that you have a bit more space between the entries and exits. It's all possible, but this was in New Zealand, very successful farm. Also a very good treatment facility, so it doesn't matter what system you have, you need a good treatment facility where you can automatically select cows after milking, and then you can treat them. So, to summarize this session, we're already 15 minutes on the run. My name is Joep Driessen. I'm a cow singles trainer for 20 years now. We made a whole series of books. Jan Huls is the author of all the books, and from Holland, we're trying to reach the world. We are now in 66 countries and educating trainers. We work now with a team of 22 people from my new training center in Holland, and the biggest aim is to train more trainers. We have now 400 trainers on cow singles in the world. And I hope you want to be the next one. We do a 4-day training where we learn you a lot about people skills, how to do a facilitating of groups of people. We learn you about cow signals, and we always have a little look on barn design, because the barn and the people decide, the management and the system decide how happy the cow will be. And the cow knows what she wants, because the people don't really realize that, and the barn designers have no clue about cows, mainly. So, if you want to learn more, we have a whole series of books. They're all really, really good books. Jan Hulst is really a brilliant author. The Building for the Cow and Robotic Milking was done together with Jack Rodenberg, also a very, very good guy in the field. So if you want to learn more, come to us, and our barn design team can help you. Or if you want to do cow signals training, where we really focus on rumen fill, body condition score, and weighting cows, what are cows trying to tell you, how to improve your systems. You heard a little bit about it today. It's actually possible. We have 400 trainers now in 55 countries. And I hope, especially the guys calling from countries where we have no trainers yet, to train more people. We want to have group sessions like this. We learned that farmers listen to farmers, and farmers don't listen very well to advisors. So if you are an advisor, you can really improve your impact on the dairy industry if you start group sessions in the house, in the field, in the barn, and around the cow. And that's what we're trying to do. We want to help you to be a better, successful presenter and communicator, and learn to do a very good cow sense workshop in the barn. That's really the best we can do. It's all about prevention of disease and owneritis, tunnel vision, narrow mindedness, and a blindness. You want to break through your own blindness. And that's why you have to look over systems and ideas. And we're really trying to reach you by very nice visuals, and a webinar already gives you 55% of the pictures, and you can hear me. We also want you to do and feel things and think about and read. But with our video learning program that we have, what you just heard now in 45 minutes, we have a 5-hour cow signals training where we go step by step, and you can do it 5 minutes every Monday, for example. It's online, it's for 1 year available, and if you sign in for this for 300 euros, and we can even going to send you a knowledge voucher, a discount voucher for 50 euros if you were in this webinar. So if you want to learn more, we have cow signals, hoof signals, and young stock signals. They're all three very good. We're working on feeding signals, stress relationship signals. And even if you don't want to come to Holland for the 4-day training, you can become a trainer by just doing our video program online, which is all about cow signals and also people signals. That's also fully video based, and I'm sure you're going to love it. It's really good stuff. So summarizing this robot session, the three success factors are cows have to be healthy, and that's all about cow signals. Healthy claws is essential, so you have to find a good football solution. We have some 5 or 10 minutes for questions after this. So, but food bus solution I didn't cover in this session. The cow has to have excellent access. We covered a bit about this. And the cow needs a reward. And if you see a waiting cow, you know you did something wrong. And it's better to do something wrong on paper than when you pour the concrete. So we really like you to come for a second opinion, do some FaceTime sessions with our barn design team. It's all on cowsignals.com or vetvice.com. Find more of our stuff. Okay, guys, thank you for watching. This was Cow Signals. Nicholas, back to the studio.
Thank you, Joep, for your insight. I think you've done a really fantastic presentation. I think you've left all of us at all with this approach, and I think there are a lot of very key, clear take-home messages, and definitely a lot of work to be done on farms. There was a couple of questions that came through, and we'll probably discuss them. One was, how do you design feeding systems or farm systems for cows with different sizes? For example, when designing a rail system or a feeding lane, how do you design for different cow sizes?
Yeah, we that's a good one. If you look at, you still have the screen on here with the 6 robots. Let me have a look. You have the screen still on, right? Can you see the picture still?
Yeah, we can see you.
So we design. We have been designing 3 robots in a row here, and then we design one third of the barn like this. You see my mouse? This here.
Yep.
One robot and 60 beds. We make one robot with 60 beds, and then we make 2 robots, these 2 robots, with the other 120 beds. So then we have a heifer group and small cow group where we make the beds a bit smaller and we can make the feeding table a bit more adjusted. And then we can have two systems in one barn. Normally we have with two or three rows, we have only one group of cows, like you have in your grazing systems, they have one group of cows. So you have to do one size fits all. It's like it was, when I was in the army in Holland, they had only two sizes for clothing, too large and too little. So it never fitted. So it's actually difficult. The answer is probably breeding, trying to breed a uniform cow size. And secondly, adapted to the biggest cow. So you will have some heifers that step out with 1 foot because they can hardly eat over the wall. They just climb over the wall with 1 foot. But if it's only one out of 100 cows, it's not a big disaster. If you have more cows standing in the feed, that's not so nice either. And then you bring shit in the feed by the cow's feet. So a feed fence is the most universal, or the green version from Canada, where you have a flexible, straight green stick standing up, flexible. So that's actually probably the best. One big thing about feed space is the wall should not be higher than 50 centimeters. That's the maximum of the wall size. And if you buy a feed fence, the feed fence should be at least 110 centimeters big, because it should be from 50 centimeters to 160 centimeters. No barrier that they can be bothered on their breastbone and on their neck. So you really want to look at it. I'm actually having a student on it now to make it even better. In the building for the cow book, we have a setter, but I'm not satisfied. It's too, still too small. So the feed fence should be tipped over 30 centimeters, and the eating hole should be big enough, 22 centimeters wide, and it has to be low enough. And the feed rail has to be at least 40 centimeters out on Holstein cows. I'm talking about Holstein cows now, 40 centimeters out, 25 to 40, maybe 35 would be the line to keep the cow still in. And the wall should be 50 centimeters. So 35 centimeters out and 120 centimeters up, I think that will be the ideal place for large cows.
That's very good, yeah. There was another question.
Cows will fall out if you have heifers introduction. One big thing is the heifer introduction in the herd. When heifers come in the herd, you have to really do a good job of stress-free stockmanship, because if the heifers are wild or cows don't trust them, or the building is overstocked, they will tip them out over the feeding wall. They kick them over and end up in the feeding table. This only happens not very regularly, so it's not a big deal.
But we've seen problems here in Australia. I was monitoring 9 commercial farms in Australia over 12 months, and heifer performance was one of the issues, and some might be due to training or the size of those heifers. So there is some work to be done there. There was another question, Joep, about how to manage robotic farms and cow behavior, cow flow in hot environments. So how do I manage this, and where should I put the fans and all that? And the same person asked if you do recommend dropping cow numbers on robots, so instead of having 60, having 50 cows per robot, which might allow for some spare time in the robots, especially that early hours of the day, the 2 to 5 a.m., that is tricky to fill in grazing, but also in barns.
Yeah. The last part I didn't understand. Say it again, last part.
So do you recommend, instead of having 60 cows per robot, dropping the cow numbers to 50 cows per robot to allow for better cow space and flexibility in the system?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, the farm today had 50 cows on the robot. It was yesterday, he had 100 cows, and he had 5 hours grazing, so he just kicked all the cows out to the other side of the street, so he couldn't let them go back in. And then he kicked them out again in the field behind the robots, and he has 6 hours out, and he still has 2.5 milkings, but he has 2.9 or 3 in the summer, in the wintertime. So the amount of milkings dropped a bit, and the amount of liters drops also a little bit with grazing. So if you have more spare time on the robot, but then it's more expensive, of course, to have robots not used to the max potential. So that's a bit of a debate. It's your personal choice. And if you have less cows per robot, if you have 60 cows per robot, you have a very easy life. If you put 70 cows per robot, you're very busy catching cows and you have to collect more cows. So The optimum is 60 cows of 10,000 liters, and if you have less liters per cow, you can have probably a few more cows per robot. The other question with ventilators, fans, in a robot system, you first of all want to have no flies in the robot, so you want to have little fans in the robot houses and where the cows are milked, so that you have some airflow here, and there's no bad smell and bad flies hanging around where the milk is and where the cows are. So that's the first place to have good airflow, if you're full of your robots. Actually, the very first place is the pre-calving yard. You look at my picture here, you see my mouse. The pre-calving yard, that's the most important place to have a fan. So the robots, maybe number one. Number two is the pre-calving cows and the fresh cows. So you like to fan this area for two reasons. One, because it's a straw pack and it dries a straw pack and you have less risk for mastitis. Secondly, you don't want to have epimetal displacements, and you want to have maximum feed intake per cow. So if you cool these cows, they have maximum resting and feeding. The next place is the cubicle. So we put a fan here, 1.5 meter wide fan. It can throw the air 50 meters. One fan here, the next fan here, and we angle them a little bit down to the ground so you have a very good cross fanning over all the cubicles. Don't make any walls. People still make walls on the end of cubicle rows, which is a stupid mistake because there's no reason for putting a wall there. Cows like to see what happens. Cows like to have a visual. You like to see the cows. So don't build any walls in any climate, in any system, because it's a big mistake to build walls, and cows want to see you. There's even farmers that came up with a glass wall in the back of the robot house because they want to give the cows a visual. So that was a very interesting one, and that, yeah, you need to clean it several times a month. But a glass back wall is probably maybe too much, but we want to make the robot boxes as small as possible so that the cows can still look behind them and around them because they don't want to feel alone behind a wall. So the walls are also blocking all the ventilation. So as little as possible robot boxes. In cold climates, I don't know who is watching from which place of the world, but cold climates, we make a heater in the robot box to make sure that the robot can't freeze, and a very good ring line on the water system. But heat stress is a bigger issue in the world than cold stress, I think, and therefore you want to have good fanning. So the first fans are here, 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 and here, and then you have it four or six fans. You have the whole rows of bed schools. That's where the cow is 14 hours. The next place is here where the cow is 6 hours eating, so that will be the next fans. But you can only spend your money once, so you have to see one, two, three, four places where you have fans. And also very important is that you also going to buy a system that is only fanning when it starts at 17 degrees. In Holland, we see that we have the fans used for 7 months a year. In Holland, in our relatively cold climate, 7 months a year, the fan is running for sometimes only an hour per day at midday, because then the temperature is going over over the 17 degrees.
Yeah, here we have a couple of farms that are in very hot and humid regions, so fans or heat stress systems are important. That's why we don't use water either as an incentive to manage cow traffic. So that's one of the.
Yeah, that's another one. We want to have definitely also water outside. There's some French farms I've seen, and even some Dutch, but very few, have no water in the field. I think that's a big mistake. You want to have completely free cow traffic. And what we do with the grazeway, I didn't explain it, but probably most people know it. If you give them only the first 4 hours after milking, they have the right to go out. So in a full grazing system, they can always go out right away to ABC fields. But what we do in a house system with grazing, the first 4 hours, they can go out after milking, and then they have to stay in because we don't want them to miss their 8-hour time slot. So then they first have to go back for milking after 8 hours after the first milking, and then they can go out again. So the grazeway is limiting the cows to go out that have 10 liters already in the udder. Every 10 liters we like to milk the cow. It's 20 liters in grazing system, it's 30 liters in house systems, And then we milk it three times a day, 10 liters. That's the idea. So if you have less liters, they, really don't, they also don't need so many milkings.
Yeah, I've seen some of those systems in Ireland. In Australia, most of them are grazing all year round. So so that's a tricky thing. There was also another question of, you mentioned 6 to 8 meters in front of the robot. Is that square meters, lineal meters?
No, lineal meters. Lineal from here, from the water trough till the first gate should be 4 to 6 meters. There's also a half a meter for the water trough and a meter for the gating. So we want to have the opening at least 4 to 5 meters free open space. So we typically design from the first cubicle till the robot box, we design 8 meters.
Yep.
And then that's 8 meters in the design, so that you still have an effective 5 meters freedom here. And that's with a 2-robot barn. If you have a 4-robot barn, you probably want to even go a meter more. But this is a very expensive space, but very, very useful space, because it saves you a lot of labor in the future. You have to have less cows to catch. Cows will voluntarily come here because of the space, and they will be easily flipping into the robot and coming out. So they have more voluntary milkings if you have more free space here. And we typically put the brush here in the middle. This opening is normally four or five meters, where we have a drinker and a brush that the cows can get out of the way brushing, that you don't have too much traffic here, that cows that are here are coming also for milking. But you also find cows in heat here. So you need excellent grip on the floor. A big mistake is made in Holland with eco floors, with so-called environmental friendly floors. It's a big joke because they are far too slippery and cows can't walk on that. So that's a mistake. We need rubber on the floors, or we need excellent grip on the floor for the cows. And we want to have the 10% of the cows in a stress-free calving line and the rest of the cows in deep beds. So for the last time, a soft deep bed is a big success factor, a stress-free calving line for 10% of the cows, 5 to 10% of the cows, and a feeding space 70 centimeter for a cow and 85 centimeter for a dry cow. These are essentials.
That's very good. There's two questions from two robotic farmers in Australia. One is, he's a grazing farmer and considering a feed pad. Do you recommend the feed pad before milking, after milking, or...
Yeah, I saw the question. I didn't answer it because I don't know the answer.
I actually did some of that research as part of my PhD here in Australia, and what we saw is that the greatest benefit was seen by offering the feed access after milking, because by doing that we reduced the amount of time cows stood on concrete, both in the feed pad and in the waiting yard.
Yeah. So exactly. I was thinking they have to be attracted to the robot and walk in voluntarily, so that's because of the cookie. So if they're already fully fed with starch feed, they probably won't go as quickly into the robot and they will hang around longer. So probably after that, at the moment they have been milked, they go out again and then they have this feed pattern. That would be my suggestion, but I don't know. I think that's probably better. But you really want to look at the cows, they want to minimize standing time on concrete, and then you have to try what works best for you.
Yeah, and the other question of the farmer was, where do you manage the balance between achieving a lot of liters or kilograms of milk per box, per robot, and pushing a lot of cows? So if I want to have, let's say, 60 cows milking 2.5 times a day, I will achieve a lot of milk per box, but it's also challenging on the cows because there's less space or less time if something breaks down or if cows to find a way through, and if anything happens on the robot or whatever, cows struggle to find the time to recover and get back on track.
True, yeah, very true. So don't push it too hard, you make your life difficult. So if you're staring blind on money per cubicle, in the end you have a horrible life. So why do you buy robots? It's also for you can spend more time with the cows and less with a routine job like milking is. So but you shouldn't push the limits. We see in Holland we are on 30 liters, some are 35 liters, but this is with 3.6% protein and 4.5% fat. So we have very high, if I talk about 30 liters, we have very high protein. So in America, they often go to 40 liters, but they have 3.1% protein. So 0.6% more protein is sometimes the difference between American figures and liters and in Holland. So it's good to know what we're talking about. We have very intensive systems. We typically go to 60, 65 cows with 10,000 liters, and that works really well. And then we have only 3 cows to fetch out of 100 cows. So that works. I know that is possible, but then you need Again, excellent deep soft beds, that's your biggest success factor and a stress-free calving line. One question also was the compost barn. I didn't mention the compost barn. It's temporarily illegalized in Holland because they had like heat-resistant spores in the compost pack. But it is the best system, or a big straw yard for all the cows. So countries where the straw is cheap and available, we won't be bothered about cubicles. We just put straw in, excellent ventilation, and you have the very best system because you have even more resting time in a straw pack, maybe half an hour extra compared to very good sand cubicles. But sand cubicles and a straw yard is almost the same resting behavior, and sand cubicles are easier to manage and to clean than, and cheaper to manage than straw in most countries. That's why we minimize the straw yard for only 5 to 10 week cows. Fresh in the week are here together, and they can walk to the row by themselves.
Well, that's a very good point. Okay, Joep, I won't take much more of your time. I do appreciate your time and dedication to share this knowledge with us.
Thank you.
It's been really, really very fantastic. There's been a lot of insights that I think are very, very good for the audience. So I do appreciate. I know that you've offered a discount for those interested in the video learning material. So I will be sharing that discount with the people that attended this webinar and the emails. But I do honestly want to thank you for your time, because I know you're a very busy man. You're talking and traveling all around the world showing this concept. So I do really appreciate. So for more information, I encourage you to visit our website, the New South Wales Department of Primary Industries website, where you will be able to access tools and resources about the dairy industry. And there's a specific section for robotic milking systems that includes a lot of information, not only on robotic milking, but also on precision dairy farming. And there's Joep's book on robotic milking too, an excellent resource. I've got it. So once again, thank you all very much for joining today, and hope to see you the next time we have these webinars. Thank you very much.